Subcommittee will come to order. Good morning. Today, the subcommittee will examine the Treasury's responses to the financial crises and the implementation of TARP. We are pleased to have two key witnesses on this topic. Leading off will be Herbert Allison, Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for the Financial Stability, who oversees the TARP program. He will be followed by Neil Barofsky, the Special Inspector General for TARP. The financial crisis caused the deepest economic decline since the Great Depression in the early 1930s. Although the economy has stabilized since the free fall of late 2008 and early 2009, credit continues to shrink and unemployment remains near 10%. We have a long way to go before most Americans will feel that the economy is back on its feet again. We need to understand the role TARP has played or could play in responding to our economic problems. TARP funds have been used for a variety of purposes. Roughly 700 banks have received capital infusions totaling more than $200 billion, with several major modifications along the way. TARP funds have been used to provide mortgage modifications to homeowners. Support for the auto industry has totaled more than $80 billion. Funds were set aside to back up efforts to revive flows for credit for small businesses, students, and consumer credit cards. TARP funds have also provided a backstop for Federal Reserve actions with AIG. There is also a budget angle to today's hearing. The TARP legislation allows Treasury to spend on administration whatever it decides without further congressional check. To decide how much to appropriate for Treasury, however, this subcommittee needs to understand how much Treasury is spending because of TARP and where it draws the line between appropriated funds and TARP-related money. In addition, the TARP legislation created the SIGTARP and provided it with $50 million that authorizes tell us they expect it to last the life of the TARP. They were granted another $15 million last spring. Last October, SIGTARP came to our subcommittee with an urgent request for $23 million to avoid having to shut down this spring. In other words, SIGTARP had made hiring and other commitments that far exceeded the funds that the authorizers thought sufficient to last through the life of TARP. We provided those funds for FY 2010, and SIGTARP has requested another $49 million for FY 2011, far more than the $30 million annual budget for the Treasury Department's IG. We look forward to hearing from our witnesses how effective each of the various TARP initiatives have been in restoring a healthy flow of credit, a growing economy, and relief for worthy borrowers. And we welcome you to our hearing today. With those opening remarks, I would like to recognize Ms. Emerson for any comments she may want.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Allison, thank you so much for being here today. We're grateful to you. The Emergency Economic Stabilization Act was passed by Congress to buy troubled assets. I'm very disappointed that both the current and the former administrations have instead used this authority to bail out banks and to become majority or nearly majority owners of AIG, Citigroup, and auto manufacturers. Acquiring stock shares and lending hundreds of billions of borrowed dollars across the financial sector with little accountability or transparency in return is not what we in Congress intended. It's impossible to justify to taxpayers why banks received billions of dollars without being required to increase lending, account for the funds they received, or take meaningful steps to limit executive compensation. Most of the experts I talk to in Missouri see little sign of how TARP improved the financial environment they work in every day, and I'm concerned that the many of the troubled assets TARP was meant to purchase still exist. They may still be out there hindering our economic recovery. No way do the expenditures of TARP to rescue troubled assets even begin to approach the estimates still being made today of how many troubled assets continue to exist in our country's financial sector. Despite the taxpayers' investment in banks in 2008 and 2009, the FDIC reported that bank lending declined in 2009. The Missouri small business folks I talked to all tell me that credit is still very, very hard to get, even for businesses with perfect, and I mean perfect, credit histories. In addition, meaningful steps to reform executive compensation have not been taken. Home foreclosures and unemployment are still unacceptably high, and some experts predict a crisis in the commercial real estate market. Understand that $186 billion of TARP funds have been returned, and I'm very pleased that Secretary Geithner previously testified before our full committee saying that the funds repaid to TARP should be used for deficit reduction and not new government spending. Regarding the cost of the Office of Financial Stability, regarding the cost that y'all's office incurs to administer the TARP programs, I am concerned that you estimate spending at $298 million in mandatory funding for fiscal year 2011. And I hope that you'll explain this to us, because I need to understand why this level of administrative spending is necessary, given that most of the TARP funds banks received have been returned, and all of the TARP programs should be winding down during fiscal 2011. Despite my concerns, I know that you and all of the staff at the Office of Financial Stability are working hard to improve our nation's economy, and I am grateful and appreciative of your efforts. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Allison, you know the drill. 5-minute presentation, your full statement will go in the record, and then we can ask you some questions. Please proceed.
Thank you very much, Chairman Serrano and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today regarding the Troubled Asset Relief Program, or TARP. Many Americans believe that the federal government bailed out Wall Street and forgot about Main Street. But what many Americans at first viewed as a distant financial crisis on Wall Street posed the risk of devastating consequences for Main Street. In the fall of 2008, we faced the possibility of a second Great Depression. Credit markets froze, and people lost confidence in the banking system. Without credit and confidence, our financial system was facing collapse. Had that happened, people would have not been able to use their credit cards to buy gas or groceries. Families would not have been able to get a loan to buy a car or send their kids to college. Businesses large and small would not have had the credit to buy inventory or pay their workers. People were seeing the values of their homes plummet and their retirement savings shrink. Without bold action, job losses that were already growing could have skyrocketed and our economy could have collapsed. So our government took unpopular but necessary steps, like creating the TARP program, to avert complete failure of the financial system. Before we could start economic recovery, we first had to achieve financial stability. The American Recovery and Reinvestment Act and the Financial Stability Plan launched by the Obama administration provided economic stimulus and restored liquidity that have enabled business to resume hiring, provided much-needed financing to states, and improved consumer confidence. With the new administration, the focus of TARP changed from primarily investing in larger financial institutions to helping homeowners avoid foreclosures and improving small business lending. For the past year, TARP has been assisting distressed homeowners through the Home Affordable Modification Program, or HAMP, and other innovative methods. HAMP is now providing substantial relief to more than 1 million homeowners. Their mortgage payments have been reduced by about a third, or about $500 per month on average, for an estimated total savings of more than $3 billion to date. We've recently enhanced HAMP to help more homeowners whose mortgages are underwater and those who are temporarily unemployed, to assure homeowners that they won't face foreclosure while being considered for a mortgage modification. We've also launched an innovative program to provide additional relief to the 10 states hardest hit by the mortgage crisis and high unemployment. The administration is also focusing its financial recovery efforts on small business. We're now seeking legislation to create a new $30 billion small business lending fund outside of TARP that would provide small and mid-sized banks with capital on terms with strong incentives to increase small business lending. Additionally, Treasury will provide TARP funds to community development financial institutions, or CDFIs, to lend to small business. CDFIs play a vital role in providing financial services to some of the hardest hit and poorest communities. Together, TARP and the Recovery Act are already producing positive results. Jobs are being created, borrowing costs for state and local governments have been reduced, securities markets essentially frozen 15 months ago have reopened, and housing markets are showing signs of stabilizing. With improving economic conditions and careful stewardship of taxpayers' money. TARP investments are delivering better returns than originally expected. We estimate that TARP will ultimately cost about $120 billion, far less than the maximum $700 billion appropriated by Congress. $200 billion in repayments and income from TARP investments have already been reused to reduce the national debt. If Congress joins the President in enacting a financial recovery fee, TARP will not cost the American taxpayers a dime. Because of the bold actions taken by Congress and the administration, our financial markets are more stable and signs of recovery are increasingly visible on Main Street. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer your questions.
Thank you so much for your testimony. Let me just on your last comment, what you're saying, I think, is that we may allocate as much as the $700 billion, but at the end of the day, it may cost 120, because the rest would have been paid back?
Yes, that's correct. In fact, we have not invested the entire $700 billion. We plan to invest about $535 billion. And already we've seen that the investments in the banks, which amounted to about $245 billion, have produced returns of about $20 billion. And we've been paid back about 70% of that money.
So did we, the Congress or the administration, overestimate the need? Because it was what, 787, right? Was the
yes. Well, that was the. That
oh,
was
I'm sorry.
The, that was the stimulus act.
Well, the numbers here, numbers there. Okay.
Actually, many people.
Well, that's an area code in Puerto Rico.
Right.
Either way.
A lot of people conflate the Recovery Act with TARP.
Right.
And TARP's purpose was to achieve financial stability.
Right, right.
And of course, ARA was to recover the economy.
Right. But you're saying that at the end of the day, it may cost $120 million.
It could. Now,
but then you also said it may not cost a dime.
Exactly. Now, let me explain that. A year ago, the estimated cost was $341 billion. By last fall, the estimate was down to $117 billion. That's the number I'm using here today. We'll be updating this number again. We expect that the cost could come down further. We've been encouraged by developments at AIG and General Motors, the car companies. We are starting the sale of Citigroup shares very soon, and we are doing our best to move out of these investments as rapidly as we can, consistent with protecting the interests of taxpayers.
Okay, I would just give you a little bit of advice, which usually we give at the end of the hearing, not at the beginning, but whatever office it is you have that puts out that information, I think Ms. Emerson would agree with us, should be putting it out a little better, because the public's perception is that it may be going down a hole. And you're telling us that at the end of the day, it may not cost a penny. So I think people need to know that. Mr. Allison, as we consider the Treasury and SIGTARP budgets for next year, it is helpful to understand your plans for TARP activity and the relationship between your budget and the rest of the Treasury budget. You run the Office of Financial Stability, where most of the TARP administrative expenses seem to be incurred. Our regular appropriations has always funded Treasury efforts on financial stability. How does the department decide what TARP pays for and what the regular Treasury appropriation pays for?
Yes. We keep very careful track of our expenditures. We have our own finance department within TARP, which is unusual for a government program. We've also established an internal review department within TARP that monitors all of our expenditures. They're currently auditing these expenditures to make sure that all of the money allocated to TARP is spent only on TARP activities and not on Treasury activities.
And you, that's pretty much established? I mean, if people were to look at it, the press was to ask, you could see that clearly?
And we also work closely, our own financial people work closely with the GAO and the Special Inspector General and other oversight bodies. Who are also concerned with making sure that we only spend TARP funds on TARP matters.
Also, last June, the report language for our bill asked the Treasury for detailed information on the staffing and budget for specific TARP-related activities. On March 10th, when I expressed my disappointment in the information that had been provided, Secretary Geithner replied, and I quote, "We will provide that information as quickly as we can." I assume we can do it quite quickly, but I just want to underscore we are now in the process of winding down TARP. That's the end of his quote. 6 weeks later, we have yet to receive any additional information as for winding down TARP. The budget documents show the FTEs in your Office of Financial Stability are expected to increase from 260 this year to 271 next year. So the question is, when will the department finally provide us with how the TARP-funded staff is being assigned by subject area specified in our report language, and the same for your contract employees? And the February budget documents for your office show an estimate for contracted services this year at $314 million, up from an initial estimated $213. What are the services that you are buying, and why did the estimate go up almost 50%?
Yes, first of all, we are still increasing our staff. We expect that our staff could be in the high 260s or in the 270s by the end of this fiscal year. After that, it will begin coming down somewhat. It'll be, we project 271, as you mentioned, for the end of the next fiscal year. The reason why the staff is still increasing is that we're still improving our control systems, and we're building systems that can last us the years that TARP continues to operate. Even though we will stop making new investments on October 3rd, we will still have to monitor these investments. We're very concerned about protecting the taxpayers' interest. That means having very strong controls and oversight and reporting capabilities. So our increases are devoted to those functions. And we will be winding down other parts of our program over time as we are repaid. Now, as we have, while we've received about 70% of the funds back from the banks, relatively few banks accounted for those funds. And so we still have well over 600 banks whose monies we have to oversee. So the burden on the staff has not been reduced materially by being paid back all those funds.
You say there are 600 banks that they
have? Over 600 banks, yes. And this is primarily today. It's no longer a large bank program. The large banks have repaid. Today, we have over 600 banks that are mid-sized and small banks. So our program today is a small, mid-sized bank program, not a large bank program. But it requires that we monitor funds of 600 different institutions.
And what is it that these small and mid-sized banks are not doing? They're not reporting back on time?
No, actually, the banks are reporting.
Right.
We require reports from them
right.
Monthly and quarterly. By the way, those are all disclosed on our website. We also disclose all of our transactions and have within 48 hours after the transactions are consummated. We provide fulsome reporting, and we continue to improve our reporting for the public, and that's available on financialstability.gov.
Thank you. Ms. Embers.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Allison. One of the things that really is still troubling me, and maybe you can make me feel better about this, and that really is the question of the viability of our financial institutions. I watch and hear from different economists, sort of from one spectrum to the other philosophically, talking about the current tactics of financial institutions is to kind of extend and pretend with the mountain of debt caused by assets still on their books from the collapse of the mortgage-backed derivatives markets in 2008. And so I'm really worried still that we haven't gotten to the crux of the problem yet. And back in November of 2009, Dominique Strauss-Kahn of the IMF said that only 50% of all the bad assets held by banks that had been declared to that date. And on October the 26th, IMF is actually scheduled to release the next Global Financial Stability Report. And we've been told that the percentage of unreported bad assets may go up as high as 66% in that document. So I guess I have four short questions to ask you. One, if you agree with Mr. Strauss-Kahn's numbers, how would you define a bad asset? As banks leave the TARP, what provisions are being made for ensuring a more complete disclosure on remaining bad assets? And four, have you all looked at why the audits for the banks have not been used to disclose these bad assets?
Well, the first of all, we have been watching the situation of the mid-sized and smaller banks. You referred to the commercial real estate and bank portfolios. Those are concentrated primarily in mid-sized and smaller banks. These are banks to which we still have advanced funds, as I mentioned earlier. By the way, we do not get repaid until the regulators of the banks approve repayments. And the regulators are the ones who are most responsible for overseeing the financial condition of the banks. That's not a function of the Treasury Department. So again, we rely on the regulators. However, as we've looked at the commercial real estate issue, while we do think it's a serious challenge for these institutions, we do see that actions are being taken to moderate that problem. There have been, first of all, write-downs of those assets, and therefore their values today have been written down in many cases substantially to closer to the present value of those investments. And so we are pleased to see that the accounting is coming to terms with the actual condition of those assets.
Do you believe that all the bad assets, I mean, they've been written down, but I mean, how, you know, what do you all estimate still exists in the financial community? And I need you to define what you believe a bad asset is.
Well, I think what we found, at bad asset is a vague term, of course, and I don't think we have a precise definition for what a bad asset is. However, there were assets that were seriously troubled because they could not be traded. They couldn't easily be valued because there were no markets that were highly liquid at that time during the height of the crisis. So banks didn't know, in some cases, what the assets were worth or what the other bank's assets were worth. And so trading between banks, which is necessary for a fully functioning money market, for example, was breaking
right.
down. That's why TARP was so necessary, to provide additional confidence. I think now some markets have reopened. Spreads on assets are down substantially, meaning that those assets are viewed as less troubled today than they were a year and a half ago. And there's been a tremendous improvement in credit spreads, which are indicative of the risk seen in those assets by the market. So I think what you see is the situation of the banks is much healthier than it was before. Many banks of all sizes have improved their capital ratios. They hold more equity and other capital as percentage of their total assets today, so they're better able to support those assets. At the same time, the assets have been written down in value. So the overall condition of these banks, by and large, is far stronger than it was before.
But yet they're doing nothing about lending to small businesses. That you know, they're not taking, I mean, when they've got customers who seriously, and this, I've had several meetings over the last few weeks with small business people who have tremendously perfect credit scores, who actually have been growing their businesses in spite of the bad economy, and yet either they can get loans at 8%, which is ridiculous, given the fact that the banks are borrowing at zero, or you know maybe 0.2% or something like that, and yet they're not lending out any money. And then, you know, the examiners are saying, well, they're being very specific or very difficult, on the one hand. But then you're saying that the regulators are really the people who are in charge, but yet the regulators are also the people who let us down in the first place. So. I'm not as optimistic as perhaps you are, and I need you to, guess, convince me that I should be.
All right. Well, Congresswoman Emerson, you point out an issue of real concern, and we agree that lending did decline. Small businesses especially have been hard hit by this because they don't have the same access to the capital markets that larger corporations do. And small businesses are the creator of many jobs in this country, so it's vitally important that they have access to borrowings and capital. So we've been meeting with small businesses and with banks of all sizes, including just last week, to ascertain from them what's the state of lending. Now, it's normal that in a deep recession like we've just had, lending contracts for a number of reasons. First of all, the banks are suffering losses. They pull back. They're trying to conserve capital. They're very cautious. They raise their lending standards typically. small businesses and large businesses pulled back initially as well because they were concerned about dropping revenues and they weren't sure they wanted to take on the risk of additional borrowings. Now the economy has improved significantly and the financial markets have as well. We've been told by banks as recently as last week that they anticipate increasing loans to small business, for example, this year. They were uniform in saying this to us. Now we're going to be meeting with them every quarter because we want to make sure that they're following through with this. We also have proposed to Congress the establishment of a $30 billion small business loan fund, and it has terms in it, if it's passed, that would provide very strong encouragement to banks to lend, because the more they lend, the lower the dividend rate that they'll be paying on this capital. But they're going to have to perform before the rate comes down.
I appreciate that, and we'll follow up when it's sure. My next turn to ask questions on the small business lending. Thanks.
Thanks.
Commenting on when your next turn comes up, we will have better attendance than usual today, so we will, and we have some votes lurking in the near future, so we will adhere to the 5-minute rule. With that in mind, Mr. Edwards.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Allison, as I recall, according to former President Bush, his chairman of the Federal Reserve, Mr. Bernanke, and his Secretary of the Treasury, Mr. Paulson, all said in the fall of 2008 that we were potentially on the edge of facing a second Great Depression. I realize there are some today that in Washington that, for whatever reasons, would elevate the Herbert Hoover approach to preventing depressions to some exalted level. I am one who felt we needed to along with President Bush, I agree, we needed to take aggressive action. There are some who would suggest that TARP was a terrible mistake. I would suggest to them that they should go back and see what happened to the stock market in the last 3 minutes of the first vote of TARP, when literally hundreds of billions of dollars of families' life savings and businesses' savings were lost, when the stock market went down 3% in the last 3 minutes of that vote, when the market realized it was actually going down. I'd have to believe if the market believed there wasn't a chance to come back and have a second vote, it might have even dropped more precipitously than that. I think some who suggest the Herbert Hoover approach to getting us out of the terrible economic disaster we were facing forget that in the year prior to the Great Depression, household wealth dropped by 3% on average. I believe in the year prior to this recession, household, or in the first year of the recession, household wealth dropped by 17%. You know, I think it was Sam Rayburn of Texas, maybe among others, who said it's awfully easy to kick down a barn. It's a lot harder to build one. I want to talk about TARP. First, my first question would be to ask you if you could send to this subcommittee a list of leading economic indicators going back to the fall of 2008, and then send us what those economic indicators are today. And I'd like to just touch on those very briefly with a couple of very specific questions that might allow a short answer. One, do you recall whether we had positive or negative economic growth in the last quarter of 2008?
I'm not sure what the growth rate was. I'll be happy to check for you.
On an annualized basis, I think it went down about 6%. And then after TARP and after the economic recovery efforts in the last quarter of 2009, if you would check, I believe that economic growth on an annualized basis went up 5.7%. A lot better going up 5.7% than down 6%. As I recall, and if you could check these numbers for our committee, the last quarter of 2008, the monthly job loss in America was about 700,000 jobs per month being lost. And I believe the last economic report said that America gained 162,000 jobs, was that last month, I believe. So instead of losing 700,000 jobs a month, we're gaining 162,000. If you would check, I believe these numbers are close to correct, but in the year of 2008, the last year of the Bush administration, the S&P 500 that a lot of businesses and families have their investments in, their children's retirement, their college funds, and their families' retirement funds, S&P went down 38%, and I believe since March of 2009, it's gone up over 70%. If you could verify those numbers, along with other economic indicators, and send that to the committee, I would appreciate it. But I would like to finally ask you specifically, and you touched on this, but had we not passed TARP, an effort to stabilize the financial system of the United States and even the world, do you think there could have been a high probability that we could have seen either a much deeper recession than we already have suffered through, or even the odds were that we could have faced an actual depression? And I remember what my father told me what it was like to go through the first Great Depression. I certainly didn't want to go through a second one. How serious of a problem were we facing in the fall of 2008 when President Bush asked Democrats and Republicans to support the financial stabilization bill?
Congressman Edwards, first of all, your comparisons are absolutely right. I think people, no one expected.
Is your microphone on, Mr. Allison? I guess it was on. I'm sorry. Please go ahead.
No one expected that we'd see the recovery this quickly a year ago. And I don't think it's possible to exaggerate how serious the financial and economic problem was in the fall of 2008. We were facing a potential catastrophe if action hadn't been taken quickly. And I think that the people who were in the government at the time, and especially the people in Congress who had a very difficult vote for TARP, were courageous and bold to do so. And I think that those actions saved the financial system and saved the economy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Another way to answer that question that Congressman Edwards is talking about, and I think it's kind of clear and straightforward. Can you tell us, in your opinion, would, if we had done nothing, would that have been more expensive or less expensive than passing a TARP program?
Well, first of all, the TARP program is going to turn out to be far less expensive than anyone expected. It already has been. And secondly, the cost to the country of a financial collapse would have been immeasurable. We would have seen the financial system essentially destroyed in this country. It literally wouldn't have been possible for people to cash checks. There was almost a run. There started to be a run on money market funds, which many people depend upon for their cash. And so the government had to step in and guarantee $3 trillion of money market funds overnight, almost, to prevent a classic run on the bank, if you will, like we saw back in the 1930s. This country depends on a strong financial system. Every day, people are using their credit cards. They're borrowing money for a car or for their house or for college education. Without this system, this economy can't function. It's part of the lifeblood of people's everyday lives. And so it was essential at the time to take unprecedented action. And because those actions were taken, we are recovering at a very rapid pace, far, far quicker than most people imagined a year ago. Now, we're not totally out of the woods.
I think whatever you're saying is that, you know, regardless how much money TARP ends up costing, and it's going to be cost less than we thought with,
yes.
That's going to be less expensive than it would have been to do nothing. And that's your opinion, and I appreciate that, because I happen to believe that.
Yeah.
Now, let me ask you, you know, everybody that comes before our subcommittee talks about we can't sustain the kind of debt that we have, both on an annual basis or our total national debt, just unsustainable. And so people talk about how to get out of that mess. They talk about raising taxes. You hear about the value-added tax. You hear about the bank tax. And let me ask you, it's interesting, because I'd like to kind of go through those numbers again to see how much TARP is going to cost. But one of the things, when you say maybe TARP doesn't cost us anything, and that'd be wonderful. But one of the proposals the president has made is a bank tax. I think he calls it a fee that'll raise $90 billion by taxing banks that have over 50 million or 50 in terms of their deposits. And one of the justifications for that tax or that fee is that that money would be used to pay back the TARP money. But you can see if TARP didn't cost us anything, then I guess you would agree that we wouldn't need that $90 billion of new taxes to pay for the TARP that didn't cost anything. Would that be correct?
What I said in my testimony, Congressman, was that we estimate, the latest estimate is, that TARP would cost about $120 billion. And
but if it didn't cost anything, well, I mean, let's assume, I hope you're right and it doesn't cost anything. Would you say, well, we don't need to talk about this fee on banks to raise $90 billion, because if you raised it, you might use it for something other than paying back TARP money, because it would have been paid back.
What I said, Congressman, was that if the financial recovery fee is enacted by Congress, TARP won't cost the taxpayers a dime, because those monies could offset.
So you're saying, best case, maybe you'd be $90 billion short, so you'd assess the fee, and that $90 billion paid off. I mean, I can appreciate that. Let me go through those numbers, because as I understand it, like, there's $700 billion, but some of the money hadn't really been spent. Isn't there about $300 million just sitting in the bank?
Well, we were authorized to spend $700 billion. We estimate that we're going to utilize about $545 or $50 billion of that money.
So that's $250 billion that you're not going to utilize.
It's about $150 billion, yes.
Okay.
And that we don't expect to utilize.
What are you going to do with that if you don't utilize it? Would you ever consider paying down the national debt or giving it back, or would you kind of hang on to it just in case you need it somewhere along the way?
Well, our ability to invest these funds expires on October 3rd of this year. And any money.
What are you going to do if you got $150 billion on October 3rd of this year?
All of that goes back.
Where does it go?
Congress. Well, we have not spent it. That would be used to reduce, along with the monies we receive back, the national debt, or the perceived planning of the national debt.
You wouldn't spend it on something else?
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All the money we receive back goes into the Treasury to reduce the national debt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Allison, for your years of service to the country. I think I want to focus on CDCI.
Yes, sir.
You alluded to it
Yes,
briefly in your opening remarks, and I think most of us understand what it's designed to be. And one of the things that we find out in our communities is that our CDCI applications have they're dragging out. They have very long waiting periods before approval or denial. Can you bring the committee up to speed on how CDCI is working in our communities, provide TARP funds in a timely manner? Because you know, obviously, the objective there is to infuse capital into our small businesses in those troubled, mostly rural areas.
Congressman Boyd, thank you for asking about the CDFIs. We believe and we know that they provide an essential service, especially in disadvantaged areas of this country that are not banked. Many banks don't even have branches in some of these areas where the CDFIs operate. So they're providing a vital and a unique role in the communities where they operate. So we believe it's very important to assure their continued operation during this very difficult time. And so we have already instituted a program for CDFIs. These are regulated CDFIs that provide the bulk of the lending and assets to these communities. And we are seeing very strong interest in this program. The application period to participate in our capital program, where we can make capital available to the CDFIs up to 5% of their risk-weighted assets on very good terms. That program, the application period expires on April 30th. So we've been urging them, and the Secretary has written a letter to the CDFIs urging them to participate in this program. And we're very encouraged by the high percentage that are showing interest. And we expect a substantial number of the regulated CDFIs to participate, which means that more capital will be available to them so they can continue and grow their activities where possible.
So you have a cutoff date for applications
Yes, sir.
Of April 30?
Yes, sir.
The approval or denial of those applications Is that already started, or
yes?
Is there anything that we can, as individual members, be doing about the expedition of the decision, approval, or denial?
Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you for your interest in this program. We're encouraged, as I mentioned, by the application rate, which is quite high, and the applications have to be processed through the regulators of these CDFIs, and I know the regulators are working hard to process those as rapidly as possible. So we do expect a large participation, and of course, we'll be reporting on all of this to the public.
Okay. Have some of those decisions, applications already been approved or denied, or they will all be coming at once?
Some applications, a large number have already been forwarded to us by the regulators, so they have been approved by the regulators.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
And I'm one who was very skeptical about voting for TARP. You know, I'm glad to see that the financial markets were stabilized, that we saved the economy from going into a depression. And I'm delighted that many of the goals of TARP have been or are being achieved. But many of my constituents don't know that. And I tell you why. Many don't have credit cards. Many don't have access to capital because they're minority, women-owned small businesses. They can't get credit. Many have lost their homes due to the scams of the loan sharks. And I hope that there will be some criminal prosecutions of these individuals. And so it's very difficult to explain. In terms of Main Street benefiting from this. So I'm curious in terms of how this administration, how you see us moving forward for those millions of people who really don't quite understand why we did this for the financial system, and why in the world we can't require these banks and lending institutions to step up to the plate and lend to minority-owned businesses and small businesses, because they're just not doing it. We had an opportune time to do that when we bailed them out. We didn't require them to do it, and now we're looking at many of our communities that are devastated as a result of the last 8 years, quite frankly. And so how do we begin to turn this around and make sure that these financial institutions that did receive TARP money know that they have a responsibility to be fair and to provide equal opportunities to small businesses and to minority-owned businesses, because they just haven't done that.
Yes. Congresswoman Lee, we fully understand and appreciate your concerns, and you've been eloquent and very strong in speaking out about these things for a long time. We've undertaken a number of programs addressed specifically at that point. The first is the CDFI program, because as you know, in many of these communities, the CDFIs are the only financial institutions that people can turn to. Secondly, the Obama administration has set up a facility of about $23 billion for housing finance agencies to innovate approaches to deal with housing issues in these communities. Thirdly, we have launched what we call the Help for the Hardest Hit Housing Markets, which is a program designed to encourage HFAs in the 10 states whose people have been hardest hit by unemployment and house price declines, to innovate solutions for those people. For instance, by helping to make more people eligible for HAMP modifications, for example, providing additional assistance to unemployed people. We also, in Treasury, have been encouraging in our programs participation by minority groups. In fact, now we're launching soon our sale of Citigroup stock, and Morgan Stanley has pledged to us that it will devote 25% of the economic receive to minority and women-owned firms. So we're encouraged about encouraging diversity. We're committed to encouraging diversity in our own programs. Much more still has to be done. And I think by shining a light on this issue and making it a high priority of the Obama administration, which in addition to TARP and the other programs I mentioned, has comprehensive stimulus efforts, recovery efforts aimed at disadvantaged communities. We have to do more. I think this administration realizes that, and they've made all-out efforts to try to help in these areas.
Great. And I appreciate what you're doing futuristically and what we're beginning to do. What I want to see, Mr. Secretary, is how, and I don't know if you have the numbers, the statistics, the reports on what lending these financial institutions, how they lended, who they lended their money to. Did they lend to minority and women-owned business? So what's the percentage? If not, we need to shine some light on it.
Yes.
I think we have anecdotal information, but I'm not sure if we have the facts. And so I'm wondering if we could ask you to get report back to this committee the types of loans and to whom those loans went to these institutions that we bailed out. Because I think it's important that never happen again. Because, you know, we raised a lot of expectations in many of these communities, and businesses have gone out of business because they could not get access to credit, regardless of whether TARP was there or not.
Yeah.
They just froze it.
Yeah. We'll be happy to follow up on that. Thank you for the question. We'll come back to you. Let me also mention, though, that in our housing program, we have extensive reporting on the performance of the servicers and making modifications available. And we've been collecting data by race, for example, and gender since the beginning of this year. And as soon as we have statistically valid information on that, we're going to start reporting that as well.
Thank you. It's very important because these scam loan sharks, that's what I call them, they targeted minority communities. I mean, they didn't just do this de facto. They went in there and decided they were going after African Americans and Latinos. So it's very important that this report come out.
Yes.
To show what has taken place. And also, I hope you'll get back to us on the lending to minority and women-owned business.
Thank you very much.
Institutions. Thank you very much.
We'll do that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you so much for your public service and for being with us this morning. And I know that all of us feel that the whole notion of stabilizing our economy and creating jobs and getting the housing markets back on track, being a Floridian, that's particularly important to make sure that we can continue to move forward. And I've read Mr. Barofsky's testimony, in which he discusses some of the missed TARP payments. And we have heard a lot of good news lately about Goldman Sachs and GM's payment of their loan, their debts in full. But I want to hear a little bit more about what you don't think is working very well and where there's been room for improvement. Which payments have you not yet received and which have been late, and are there any that you anticipate not getting back at all?
We have had some banks not paying the quarterly dividends to us. If they don't pay us for 6 quarters, we have the right to appoint 2 directors to their boards.
Okay.
We have had, though, I would say, given the magnitude of the crisis, a relatively low rate of outright losses. Today, the losses are a little over 1% of the total amount that was invested in the banks. But even with those losses, the total net return has been about 9%. On the investments, and we've received over $20 billion of dividends and warrant proceeds and interest on those investments. So overall, this plan, this program has benefited taxpayers. They've profited from this program so far substantially.
In other words, we've actually made more back than we initially invested.
We've made about $20 billion on those investments.
Wow, that's certainly something that I would love to see get out there more, because the hatred of the TARP and the whole notion of TARP has been understandable, because we certainly wish we were never in this situation in the first place. But the fact that we've made the investment back with interest to the tune of $20 billion, that's an important point that Americans should know. I want to ask you a little bit about the AIG subsidiaries, selling off AIG subsidiaries. There's a concern that AIG is selling off some of the better parts of its business just to repay the government. Is it AIG that's directing those sales, or is it the government looking to recover some of the money more quickly? And do you believe that AIG is cannibalizing its future earnings so that they can get short-term results?
First of all, let me emphasize that we are a reluctant shareholder in any of these companies.
Yes.
And we would like to dispose of our investments in the stocks of AIG, General Motors, Citigroup, as rapidly as possible, consistent with protecting the interests of taxpayers. We do not get involved in day-to-day decisions of these institutions or strategic decisions. We do expect that the asset sales that AIG is making today will enable the company to repay, first of all, the Federal Reserve for a large part of all of its investment. We do have continual communications with AIG about its condition and about its plans. We are encouraged by the progress that the company has made, and especially the last 6 or 8 months. And we've seen the risk in the company come down dramatically. Financial products, their financial product subsidiary, which was the cause of a lot of the problems in AIG, has dramatically reduced its exposures to the market. And so we see a very positive trend so far in the improvement in AIG's condition.
And Mr. Chairman, forgive me for not, I was not here when you made your opening remarks, but in my home state of Florida, restoring the housing market and helping ensure that we can keep people in their homes and not prevent them from being foreclosed on is incredibly important. Our recovery is lagging behind the rest of the country. Can you talk a little bit about the hardest hit fund, how that's going to that and other innovative ideas using TARP funds that we are designed to help make sure that we can bring that part of the economy up?
Yes, and we think that the hardest hit fund is extremely important, especially in these 10 states, and Florida, of course, is one of those, and I believe Florida is receiving more than $400 million.
Yes.
And this will enable the state, the Housing Finance Agency, and others to look at the particular conditions within Florida and certain areas of Florida to see what methods might be used to assist in stabilizing the housing markets and relieving the pressure on homeowners in those areas. And as you well know, this housing crisis is highly concentrated in certain parts of the country. Southern Florida is one that's been particularly hard hit, as you well know.
Yes.
And fortunately, what we do see are signs of stabilizing of prices, and that's going to be essential so that we attract more demand for houses and we begin to stabilize and balance supply and demand in those areas. So we are encouraged by some of these developments, even though it's been extremely painful. Maybe we're nearing the point where that market stabilizes.
Do you have that sense that we are?
Our sense is that increasingly we're seeing, and some of the hardest hit places are the ones where the prices rose the quickest.
Right.
They came down the furthest, but they're actually maybe reaching a point quicker than some other parts of the country where they have an equilibrium of supply and demand. And so,
well, your mouth to God's ears.
Pardon me? Yes. Well, we hope so. Now, we're not complacent about this. That's why we just implemented this new program. We still think we have to do more. Frankly, in the eyes
pushing
of
the banks to work mortgages out
exactly.
is incredibly
exactly.
important as
and
well.
We're also, you know, publicizing their performance, and frankly, they still have more to do.
A lot more.
All of them, and we meet with them continually, and we are seeing progress, but it's not fast enough. And I think, frankly, they need to invest more in their mortgage activities in order to reach the type of scale that we need. However, let me mention that last month is the first month when we actually saw the servicers convert more mortgages to final modifications than they had new trial modifications. So it does show capacity is increasing, and we're starting to get on top of this problem. And we expect that we will have seen decisions made on trial modifications awaiting decisions. Most of those should be completed by the end of June. But we are still working with the banks to increase their capacity. this is still a very serious problem. We still see the possibility of a million foreclosures in this country this year, maybe 3 million foreclosure starts, but usually about a quarter to a third of those turn into actual foreclosures. Mm-hmm. We're trying to prevent as many of those as we can, and that's why we have the HAMP program. And right. We're encouraged that we have over a million people who've already benefited from that, but we want to make sure that people know the program's available. We want to make sure that the servicers that we've already reached an understanding with the servicers from now on, starting in June, they must look at every 60-day plus delinquent mortgage to see whether the homeowner could be eligible for HAMP. And so that should also more people into this program. But we have to publicize it more.
Yes.
We have holding events throughout the country, including in Florida. To
let members of Congress know how we can help you publicize
Thank
it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
For your question.
Thank you for your indulgence, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Allison, as a general rule, when a company accepts federal dollars, they're subject to all the federal rules and regulations. And in this case, a company that's paid back the TARP money is still subject to all the federal guidelines that they accepted the money under, or are they completely freed of federal strings once they repay the money?
Once they have repaid the money entirely, they are free from the TARP restrictions. Of course, they're subject to all the other laws.
Certainly, but I mean, in terms of the TARP restrictions.
Yes, sir.
Now, and it's my recollection, didn't the original language of the October 2008 TARP legislation leave it, I don't know that it was mandatory, but is it the Secretary's discretion to use the money that is repaid to pay down the deficit?
The money that comes back to the Treasury that's repaid under the TARP program is put back into the general account of the U.S. Treasury for debt reduction.
For debt reduction, but yes, the Congress and this new Congress and the President have just routinely rechurned that money, so it's not. Well, let me ask you this: has any of that money been applied to debt or deficit reduction? Because if it is, I'm not aware of it. I'm not aware of any of that money being used to pay down the debt or the deficit.
Well, actually, I'd be glad to send you information on this, but so far we've received about $170 billion roughly in repayments, $186 billion,
mm-hmm.
and we've received another $20 billion in proceeds from dividends and interest and sales of warrants.
About $180 billion, and has that $180 billion all been used to pay down the debt and the deficit?
Yes, sir. Every dime is used to pay down.
Then that's terrific. Is it going to continue to be any money that's paid back used to pay down the debt or the deficit?
Absolutely, and that's under the ESA law.
So that's required. It's mandatory. Is the and it's not just, of course, the Treasury Department, but the Federal Reserve, FDIC, have all been in the business of guaranteeing loans and ensuring, helping to provide some underpinning to a whole variety of industries. How much money has, and to who has the Federal Reserve been loaning money to?
I don't have that answer off the top of my head. We'll be glad to contact the Federal Reserve and provide that information to you.
You could provide that to the committee?
We will request the Federal Reserve to provide it to you.
Have they provided it to you? Has the Department of the Treasury seen in detail how much money Federal Reserve has loaned and to who? And under what terms?
I will find the answer to that to you. But my own department doesn't look at that, but I will see whether others in Treasury have done so.
To your knowledge, has Treasury received that information from Federal Reserve?
I don't know.
How much money is the F? Do you know a ballpark figure is how much money the Federal Reserve has either loaned out or guaranteed?
I don't have that information right in front of me. But if you'd like, we'll certainly
try
to get the information for you.
What about the FDIC? I understand they're also a part of this as well.
Well, the FDIC, of course, oversees these.
Sure.
Banks. It has had its own facilities where it has guaranteed borrowings. For a period of time, that program has been terminated, however.
How has the United States government, or excuse me, U.S. taxpayers more accurately, ever guaranteed this much money in the private sector, this many loans, this much money on this broad a scale ever in U.S. history?
I don't know. I would doubt it, but there hasn't been a crisis. This is, I think, a unique financial crisis that this country faced, and as I mentioned before, my testimony would have been catastrophic if actions hadn't been taken. The cost of this economy would have been incalculable if these actions hadn't taken. And what we've seen is, thanks to these actions, the economy has recovered far faster than most people would have dared to predict.
What is the amount of money the Secretary of the Treasury has available to him to use under the TARP fund to continue to make loans or guarantees? You've got money coming back in that is repaid, but isn't there a continuing amount of money that the Secretary of the Treasury has available to continue to use at his discretion?
The amount of TARP funding was available. That was allocated to TARP was $700 billion.
Right. And you say $180 billion of that has been repaid, applied to deficit reduction,
actually,
and that's gone. That's gone to pay off debt, right?
Yes, but the entire $700 billion has not been used. And as the Secretary announced when he extended TARP to October 3rd of this year, we don't expect to use more than about $550 billion. We actually have made investments of about $390 billion, as I recall, but we plan to make, we made commitments about $491 billion, and we plan to utilize about $545 to $50 billion.
And as that money comes back in and is repaid, you will apply that specifically to debt?
That is correct.
Buying back U.S. Treasury debt?
It is done. It reduces the national deficit, yes, sir.
And then the money's not reused?
Money is not reused.
Okay.
However,
thank you, Mr. Chairman.
However, let me be totally clear with you. As the money is repaid, that increases the headroom because the actual authorization remains constant at $700 billion. However, we are totally transparent that the money that has been repaid goes back to reduce the national debt. We disclose all of the utilization of the money on our website. And the amounts that I have given you will indicate that we have not used the entire $700 billion.
Maybe someone could follow up on that, Mr. Chairman, because it's
sure.
Still a little bit of a source of confusion. The authorization level stays the same. You say you're paying down debt with it.
That's right. So,
but you can continue to churn within that $700 billion.
No, sir, because any new investment under the law, we strictly follow the ESA law. Any money returned to us is used to pay down the national debt. Within the $700 billion, we may make additional investments, but we have not come close to utilizing the entire $700 billion. So it's really a moot point. So any money we return back goes to reduce the national debt. We'll be glad to give you a table showing you exactly what has been utilized so far and how much has been paid back.
You're always gracious with the time. I have some follow-up. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
And answered about 9 times that it was going back to paying the national debt.
Okay.
Just for the record. But I understand your concern. It's the concern of many folks. Last year, the TARP was used to create new public-private investments to increase credit for small businesses, students, car buyers, and other consumers. How would you evaluate the effectiveness of these programs in making more credit available for credit-worthy small businesses, students, and consumers?
The impact has been both direct and indirect. When the public-private investment program was announced about a year ago, it had an almost immediate effect on the credit spreads for commercial mortgage-backed securities and residential mortgage-backed securities. Those rates, you can trace it to the day of the announcement. The rates came in dramatically, which helped to improve the costs of credit throughout that sector of the financial markets. And since then, we have been working with 9 investment managers to invest in these types of instruments, which help to provide additional liquidity to the market and also additional price discovery, which stabilizes and creates more confidence in those markets. Again, that program will be also fully invested soon, and we plan no others because the markets have improved so much in terms of spreads returning to near normal in many cases that there's not a need for adding to that program.
My only concern would be that that's the program that speaks, those programs speaks to areas where the people with the least power, if you will, in the society were benefited. So when you say we don't intend to add more to it or whatever, that's fine if everything is okay, but I would hope we know everything is okay before we decide to cut back on that.
Well, what we're seeing is that even as that program nears being fully invested, we're seeing that the spreads in those markets remain quite low, especially compared to where they were at the height of the crisis. Right. And they have returned to near normal in many cases. We'd like to see more activity in those markets. That's going to take some time, but they have been improving and healing thanks to these programs.
Right. In the last year, banks have reduced their credit outstanding to commercial and industrial businesses by almost 20%, or $300 billion. When businesses lose credit like that, they cut back jobs. Recently, the financial press has reported that the financial services sector has paid out more than $100 billion in bonuses this year. Do you agree that the money, if retained instead of paid out in bonuses, could have been conservatively leveraged to increase credit in our struggling economy by hundreds of billions of dollars? And what do you think will be required to get a satisfactory resumption of credit growth in the country? Treasury is required to review the executive compensation of hundreds of banks. How is that process going? And do you see any significant change in that compensation?
Well, first of all, I think many Americans have been outraged by the level of bonuses in the financial industry, especially among the largest financial institutions that receive the largest amount of TARP funds. These institutions have repaid TARP. I think what's important, our administration believes what's important, is to enact financial reform legislation that would, for example, provide for shareholders to have a say in pay for the top executives of these financial companies. I think we're going to see over time, if this is enacted, much more discussion and much more information about how pay is determined in these companies. And that, in turn, should help to lead to better control over that type of activity. We are, like you, we've been troubled by the shrinkage in lending. We do see signs, as I mentioned before, that lending is increasing. A number of the largest banks have pledged that they will increase lending here in 2010. We hope that happens as soon as possible.
Right. You know, as you speak, I think of something, and my last statement here is to kind of, for anyone who will care to listen, if they could help us with this. But the statement I just made, the question I just asked you, raises some eyebrows at City Hall back in my hometown in New York. Because, as you know, Mayor Bloomberg and others have said, sure, go after Wall Street, and in the process, you'll destroy New York's economy. And, you know, New York gets caught up in a little situation there where we know that these bonuses are totally improper and outrageous, but then taxes are collected on people who work in New York and collect those bonuses. I wish there was a way that we could come up with some sort of a presentation that would say, these restrictions do put this kind of slight pain on New York, but look at what the rest and dealing with this issue in general will do for the state and for the city. And no one has been able to do that. And I wish someone could direct me in a direction as to where we could get those numbers to indicate that while we may put restrictions on folks who work on Wall Street in New York, in the long run, it's better for New York City and New York State to have this in place rather than what we had before. Because it's not enough to say we are trying to put restrictions on the folks who caused the problem to begin with. People tend to forget, you know, they tend to forget why that we shouldn't have invaded Iraq or we should have been out of Afghanistan. You know, they forget. So they somehow forget who caused the problem. Now it's, you know, who's going to cause the current problem or the next problem or why isn't it taken care of enough? So if you know anyone that you could direct us to begin to put together a presentation that would say, yes, we will restrict, but here is the final outcome for places like New York or Chicago or financial centers throughout the nation.
I think you ask a very interesting question and make a terrific observation. Let me also mention that for the seven companies that received special assistance, what we call exceptional assistance, from TARP, the special master that was appointed by the Secretary of the Treasury directly oversaw the compensation of the top 25 executives in each of these companies. We saw that their compensation declined dramatically under the special master's oversight. Those companies are all doing better than they were before, and they're still very competitive. The administration is well aware of the need for responsibility and farsightedness in compensation awards by these companies. And the president, of course, is speaking today up in New York about the financial industry and the need for financial reform, which includes greater disclosure and a say on pay. And it's vital that shareholders have the ability to voice their views about the compensation in financial companies.
Because, as you know, the argument we get is, you know, if you keep doing this, they'll leave. Where are they going to go? I mean, they're going to quit their job on Wall Street and go elsewhere? I mean, and when you have people in my congressional district in the South Bronx who might have gotten, and I'm not being funny here, might have gotten a $100 Christmas bonus at their job, and somebody is fighting over whether to get $5 or $10 million in a bonus, I don't think it's much of an argument. Thank you. Ms. Emerson.
Thank you, Chairman. All right, let's go back to small business lending, if you could, but if we could. And you know, I'm a little bit confused here. I've got a letter from the Special Inspector General dated February 19th that says, in essence, that Treasury at first perhaps was going to include the SIGTARP in overseeing the new small business lending program, and then, or at least that's what your legislation would reflect, and then you all decided not to, but yet the way that I understand that the program has actually been designed really sounds pretty much like an extension of the capital purchase program. So I'm just a little bit confused, and perhaps you can explain to me or perhaps assure me that there's no reason at all why you all would want to involve SIGTARP's oversight in this newly proposed program. And just because it was kind of back and forth, so I'm not quite sure where we are in the process right now. Please explain.
First of all, it's important to point out that the new program would be subject to special legislation. The program would be outside of the TARP program. It is not identical to the capital purchase program. It's qualitatively different because it will be providing direct incentives for lending. It'll be geared to stimulating lending. It's not primarily, as the capital purchase program was, to bolster the capital of banks. This is to give them capital that they may need in order to expand lending. And they will only get a reduced dividend if their lending grows. We didn't think it was appropriate in the legislation for us to tell Congress how we ought to be overseen.
But you're using TARP money to do it, right?
No, we would not be using TARP money. This would be done entirely outside of TARP, under separate legislation, without using TARP funds.
Okay, but if, in fact, Congress determined that it was, you know, because of the whole SIGTARP office has really ramped up and actually has the ability to oversee this, it would not be something that y'all would push back on, would it? In other words, if in fact we decided in our legislation to have SIGTARP oversee, that's not a problem, is it?
We welcome strong oversight over all of our programs. We have oversight not only by the Special Inspector General, but by the Congressional Oversight Panel, the Financial Stability Oversight Board, and the GAO. We think that they all add value to what we do. And we will, the only advice we would give is that there should be continued strong oversight of all these programs.
Well, certainly we need to protect the taxpayer, but it seems to me if we've got an entity that's really doing its job well, we might as well just keep using them. As I said earlier, my small businesses are just troubled by the lack of their ability to access credit, and so I'm hopeful that whatever program comes about actually is going to work. Can you tell me what specific actions your office took to encourage lending, particularly from the banks receiving TARP funds, and then anything in excess of that?
We think one of the best ways, Congresswoman Emerson, to encourage lending by the banks is to shine a light on their lending practices. And so we disclose their lending, and have since the beginning, on our website. And we've also asked them to report to us periodically on how they're using TARP capital. And so, and by the way, some of those are recommendations of SIGTARP, which we thought were very constructive. We are working with banks. We've been talking to many banks about their lending practices to encourage them to try to lend responsibly. In fairness, we've seen collateral values, especially this affects small business, the value of their collateral, such as their commercial real estate that they may pledge, or their personal real estate that they may pledge in order to get a loan, has dropped substantially. And that's one reason why some banks have cut back on their credit. Nonetheless, with the stimulus activities by the government, by the funding of many programs, by the improvement in the economy, we think, and we're hearing from banks, that they're reaching an inflection point where we're likely to see a pickup in lending here in 2010, and that's very encouraging for small business and for the economy.
Well, it's certainly in almost every single newspaper article that I can read, including another article here on USA Today, banks who took a decreased lending, every single headline. And that's very troubling, given the fact that, you know, part of the whole reason that we, those of us who supported the TARP, it was to get Main Street back in business.
Let me also mention on that point, one can't just look at the loan balances on the bank's books to see what their current activity is, because banks have had to write down a lot of bad loans.
Mm-hmm.
And so even their lending activity may be stronger today, but the overall balance comes down because other loans have either matured or been written down. So one has to look at the actual lending activity of the bank, not at the balances on the bank's balance sheet, to get the real picture as to what's going on.
All I have to do is talk to small businesses in my district, and I can get the real answer to this question. And we're not talking about, you know, Bank of America banks. We're talking about big Missouri banks, just for example. But you know, I know that for much of the last year, the secondary market for many types of loans was frozen. And so whether it's mortgages, SBA loans, other asset-backed securities currently functioning, I mean, tell me what steps y'all are taking to ensure those markets do continue to function effectively, so we can move this along faster.
You've just given the rationale, Congresswoman Emerson, for this small business lending fund that we'd like Congress to enact. This program is designed specifically to encourage lending. We totally agree with your points. We hear the same anecdotes from many businesses across the country. I get letters from many of these businesses. You are pointing to a real problem, and we understand that. That's why we've designed this program. That's why we're hopeful that the Congress will enact it as soon as possible, so we can be providing capital to these banks and enabling, giving them the confidence and the capital so they can increase their lending.
So what's going to happen if we don't pass legislation?
I think it'll simply take longer for the lending to recover. Eventually, it will increase again, but we'd like to see it happening sooner rather than later. We want to help create jobs, and jobs depend on small business being able to get funding to purchase inventories, to make new investments in plant and equipment, to hire more people. And so to get the economy moving more rapidly, we think providing capital to the smaller banks, who do an outsized portion of small business lending across the country, is extremely important. I and my colleagues have been talking with many of these banks across the country in all districts. And what they tell us is that they see good quality companies that they want to be lending to. I think that we're seeing some parts of the country where lending is going to pick up a little more rapidly than other parts. But by providing the capital, we enable banks to take another look at their lending practices, to review loans that they may have turned down, but they might want to review again with the prospect of perhaps increasing lending to those companies.
Well, it is a problem, and hopefully we'll get to this issue. I would certainly encourage you all to just make it a lot easier on yourselves by saying SIGTARP can handle the oversight here. But I also just want to, before I close, I just want to mention, you know, there is another issue, and this isn't specific to our subcommittee at all, but the fact is that, you know, the credit unions are actually trying to increase the cap on their member business lending, so they, in fact, could make some of these small business loans that the banks are so reluctant to do because they have the capital to do it. And it seems to me ridiculous that the Treasury Department would be pushing back on this and saying, and this isn't in your field, but it's just a frustrating thing when you've got these very stable financial institutions wanting to do something to help keep the economy going, and, you know, Treasury's put, you know, pushing back on them, and seems to me that it would be a win-win if we were able to do something in that regard, simply to increase the inventory of financial institutions that have money to offer. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you,
Ms. Emerson. We're going to recognize the remaining members, and then we're going to try to wind down this first panel so that we can get going with the second panel. We hope to wind this before we face the impending votes on the House floor. Mr. Edwards.
Mr. Chairman, in the name of time, I have no additional questions other than I want to ditto the line of questioning of Ms. Emerson. While I believe we needed financial stabilization measures in 2008 and 2009 to keep us from going into Second Great Depression, clearly small businesses all across the country, and I certainly reflect that and see that in Texas, are having challenges. And anything we can do together to free up that liquidity in a responsible way would be very, very important.
Thank you. Mr. Cobbleson.
Thank you. Following up on that same line of questioning, I can back up what Mr. Edwards and Ms. Emerson are saying, but pointing directly to information that I've gotten, and I know they probably have heard, too, from the Associated General Contractors in Texas, the Greater Houston Builders Association, the Associated Builders and Contractors in Houston, the Houston Association of Realtors, the Texas Association of Realtors. I'm sure this is true across the country, that the banks are flush with money, and the regulators have instructed the banks to unload or real estate loans, stop loaning money to for real estate loans or commercial real estate, even if it's a blue chip borrower who has always paid back their loans. So it's a regulatory problem as well, but the banks are, these banks that receive this money are absolutely flush with money. This is within Treasury's jurisdiction. I know FDIC is a, you know, a key part of this. But I know all of us, and I suspect Mr. Edwards would join me in this. He's nodding back there. We would all encourage you. We want the banks to loan money to people that can pay it back, but they're not loaning money to people who can pay it back. To what extent can you help? Can Treasury help put pressure on the regulators to quit forcing banks to unload or stop making real estate loans to good borrowers? I mean, these are good credit risks, and they cannot, frankly, most of the home building, Chet, in Houston, I just had the Greater Houston Home Builders come see me yesterday, and several of them have gone out of business because the banks will not lend them money. And these are solid credit risks. They've always, you could have a nuclear attack from the Russians, and these guys would pay their loan back. What can you do to help get the regulators to quit pressuring the banks to stop making these loans to good credit risks?
First of all, we fully understand the importance of increasing lending to small business.
Let me to good out. Credit risk.
Yes, sir. I understand. We do not control the regulators. The regulators are totally independent from the Treasury Department. We know that they have provided additional guidance to their examiners throughout the country about lending to small business.
I have indeed. It's
yeah.
They're putting us.
Well, I would think that perhaps the regulators should speak for themselves on that issue.
You've got a role in that, though. It's atmospherics and helping to, and to the extent you can, I hope you will, as the Department of the Treasury,
yes,
do whatever you can. What can you do? It's not, they're not complete. I mean, obviously, they're independent. You want them to be. But
well, the regulators are well aware of that issue, and that's one reason why they've while they have communicated additional guidance to their supervisors and their examiners. But I would invite you to speak with the regulators directly because they are independent of the U.S. Treasury Department. We obviously have dialogue with them, but they make their own decisions.
Mr. Chairman, I know that'd be very helpful for this committee to certainly do whatever we can. obviously making sure that we want loans to be made to people who can pay them back, but they've literally, I'm sure it's happened in New York too, and in Pennsylvania, they're absolutely not making loans to creditworthy borrowers who will pay them back.
That's a fact.
And we need to do whatever we can, Mr. Chairman, to help get the regulators to quit, you know, putting the screws to the banks.
Point is well taken. It's a problem in every community in this country. Mr. Fattah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, we don't live in a socialist country. We can't dictate to the banks what they do in a free market economy. But I do empathize with much of what has been said that, you know, there's a concern about getting credit flowing. Let me start here first to really congratulate the department and its work on the TARP program. I mean, I think it's an amazing feat, an extraordinary one, and unexpected by many of the critics of the TARP program that the department would have made money and expect to make money in totality on the funds made available to banks to stem the financial crisis. The economy has bounced back significantly, and the stability inside the financial markets is obvious, I think, to everyone. And so you've done a very good job, and you've maintained stewardship over the taxpayers' money in a way that I think deserves to be noted for you and the work of Secretary Geithner. I do think that where we see a need that's not being filled in the market, it's an appropriate role for the government to step in. That's what SBA exists for, and I think that the administration's program of moving some $30 billion through CDFIs, through community banks, so that it can be available to small businesses who have good credit rate risk, I think is an appropriate role for us. And this is what we've done. Where the market has not worked in the past, the government has stepped in, and I think that that's something we should move expeditiously on. I know that the department is working on it, and the administration is working on it, and I just want to voice my support for it because I know many small businesses in the Philadelphia community who have still had some challenges, notwithstanding being very good credit risks and having, you know, in essence, vanilla deals. They've had difficulty getting loans. But I think that we don't want, on one hand, criticize banks for the risk that they took, that took the country to the edge of a financial disaster. As regulators are saying that they need to be more conscious of the risk they are assuming, and at the same time say, well, we want Treasury to put pressure on the regulators to back off. I mean, we can't have our cake and eat it too in that sense. But I do think we can step in through the Treasury, through SBA, and provide assistance. I'm more interested in what we're doing about mortgage foreclosures. And I know $1.5 billion was made available to housing finance agencies to develop programs related to the unemployed in terms of foreclosure prevention, different from the foreclosures we saw on the front end of this problem, which were largely driven through the subprime and other issues. The foreclosures that are moving through on the market now are driven in large measure because people have lost their job by no fault of their own. And it makes no sense for us to create deadbeats out of people who were taxpaying, law-abiding citizens, paying their bills, to create a situation where not only do we have a vacant home in the neighborhood and driving prices down, but also have them out on the street in their credit rating ruined for a decade or so in the cost to the taxpayer for foreclosure, which doesn't get discussed a lot, is quite substantial, somewhere above $80,000 per foreclosure. We have a program in Pennsylvania through our housing finance agency that I helped create a few decades ago that's worked very well to step in to help unemployed homeowners who have lost their job by no fault of their own, and no risk to the taxpayers. We've gotten, you know, every dollar paid back. And the average amount of help was 4 or 5 months worth of assistance to that homeowner, with those dollars being pegged to the long-term repayment of the mortgage. So I was very happy to see the Treasury's initiative focused on the hardest hit states. We have in the Wall Street Reform Bill, the House version, a $3 billion allotment to mirror those efforts throughout the country to step in to help homeowners. So I'd like to get from you what's happening with the initial one and a half billion and what these hardest hit states are doing to the degree that you can comment.
Congressman Fata, thank you very much for your comments and your question about the help for the hardest hit states. And as you know, the first billion and a half, as you said, was devoted to five states. We then allocated another $600 million to five other states. And we've received the proposals from the first five states as of last Friday. We're looking at those right now. I think you'd be pleased that the HMAP program in Pennsylvania has been looked at very closely by a number of those states as maybe they could model something after HMAP to tide people over, as you said, who are unemployed. This program is aimed at areas most affected by high unemployment and by falling housing prices. And this is a localized problem. It's acute in some particular parts of the country. And that's why we allocated the money to those particular 10 states. So we're looking forward to seeing what their proposals are, to working with them on implementing those proposals. We'll have final decisions next month on those proposals, and then they can get moving. But we totally agree with your analysis of this problem. That's why we innovated this program. And we have high hopes that it'll be truly creative and develop solutions that best suit these particular areas of the country, because they're developed by people who know those communities. And we've found that because this is a highly concentrated problem, we need local expertise to work alongside the Treasury Department and the Department of Housing and Urban Development to provide and develop the most effective solutions possible.
Let me thank you for your testimony. Let me thank the chairman.
Allison, we thank you. I have one more question to submit to the record.
Mr. Chairman, I have several to submit to the record. If you'd like to wind this down, I can wait.
We'll wind it down. And the one I do have for the record is one that probably should have been the first one, and that's tell us how you're going to wind down TARP and as TARP winds down all the information. And so we thank you for your testimony. We thank you for your service, and we thank you for what I know is your desire to keep us informed on all the different issues that we presented. As you well understand, both programs that were put forth, in our opinion, were very necessary, but they've created a lot of controversy and created a lot of questions, and that is why we ask so many questions and ask you to keep us informed.
Mr. Chairman, could I ask if I could, for the witness to provide the chairman as well the information about how much money the Federal Reserve has loaned out and to who? And under what conditions? I know the chairman would be very interested in that as well.
Chairman would be very interested in that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
In my opening statement an hour and a half ago, I told you that our next witness would be Mr. Barofsky. And we ask you now to come forward and give us your testimony. We will try to do this as painless as possible because we're running against a time constraint. I'm always amazed at how members of Congress get in so many hearings considering what we're always up against. And you know the drill, 5-minute presentation, and we'll put anything else in the record. Should be on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Emerson, members of the committee. It's a privilege to appear before you today and to testify about SIGTARP's proposed budget for 2011. As you know, in the President's budget request for 2011, he includes a request for, I think, approximately $49.6 million for the operations of SIGTARP. That proposed budget will allow us to continue to operate as the agency that stands between hundreds of billions of taxpayer dollars and those who would seek to steal, waste, or abuse them. We carry out this role in three different areas: transparency, oversight, and enforcement. Let me start with enforcement. As the only oversight body in the TARP legislation with law enforcement authority, we literally have the role as the TARP cop on the beat. And we've built a sophisticated law enforcement agency. We have 84 ongoing investigations. We've recently opened up offices in New York and about to do the same in LA and San Francisco. And we're trying to establish a nationwide presence to deter and detect TARP fraud. Our cases are as diverse as the 13 subpar TARP programs that have developed. For example, we recently arrested and got criminal charges against the president and CEO of Park Avenue Bank for his attempt to try to steal $11 million from the TARP program. We've brought criminal charges against two individuals out in California who are running a mortgage modification fraud scheme that brought in $1 million from struggling homeowners. In Tennessee, Gordon Grigg, a hedge fund executive, is serving 10 years in prison for a fraud that he was doing, trying to sell fictional investments that he called TARP-backed securities. In Atlanta, we have a number of convictions and charges related to our investigation of Omni Bank, another TARP applicant. We've executed search warrants in California against a law group that's alleged to have participated in another mortgage modification scam. And in Florida, two banks, one of which had received conditional approval and was about to receive $553 million in TARP funds that never went out the door. On the civil side, we work with the SEC and the New York State Attorney General in their investigations into the Bank of America. And all told, our investigations division has helped in the recoupment or the prevention of loss through fraud of more than $700 million. We also leverage our resources with other law enforcement agencies. We formed the TALF PPIP Task Force in New York, consisting of 8 different law enforcement agencies. We have the TARP Inspector General Council that we founded here in Washington. And we have a leading role in the President's Financial Fraud Enforcement Task Force. With respect to transparency and oversight, we do that through our auditing and reporting function. This week, we've issued our 6th comprehensive quarterly report reviewing the operations of TARP and of SIGTARP for the preceding quarter. And these reports are intended to be desk books, reference guides that try to translate all the Wall Street terminology into Main Street language. The American people have a thirst for information about this program in which they are investors. In SIGTARP, we've tried to meet that thirst with more than 42 million hits to our website since our inception. As far as audits, we've issued 8 audits to date. Just as a way of example, they've covered issues such as TARP recipients' use of funds, the impact of outside influences on the TARP application process, the decision by government officials to pay the equivalent of 100 cents on the dollar to AIG's counterparties for securities that were worth less than half of that amount, and most recently on the HAMP, the Mortgage Modification Program, the administration's response to the foreclosure crisis. We've made about 58 recommendations to date, and while many of them have been adopted, some have not, but those that have, I believe, have significantly contributed to the TARP being a better run, better executed, and most importantly, better protected against the risk of loss through fraud as a result. Finally, one of our roles is, of course, to keep the Congress informed of what's going on in TARP and what's going on in SIGTARP. And we've conducted dozens and dozens of individual member briefings, staff briefings, and today marks my 14th time testifying before Congress as the Special Inspector General to discuss what's going on in the TARP and the TARP programs. Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Emerson, again, thank you for this opportunity today, and I look forward to answering any questions you may have.
14, you say? 14 times?
This is number 14.
Wow.
We counted up for the testimony today. Right. I was surprised at the number.
I think you were here for most of the previous testimony, so I'm going to give you an opportunity to comment on the answers that Mr. Allison gave, particularly on mortgage relief and general effects of TARP on credit conditions, if you have anything you'd like to add to that.
I think that with respect to the mortgage program, the TARP mortgage program, HAMP, as I said, we recently released an audit, and have new recommendations in our most recent quarterly report. It's a program that has a lot of promise, but has had a lot of problems in execution. With only 230,000 permanent modifications more than a year into the program, it's making a very small dent into a much larger problem. We addressed that in our audit through our recommendations. There's been problems with execution. A lot of the decisions and the practices have in some ways have been rushed, which has resulted in some inefficiencies, a lot of borrower confusion, which has led to avenues for fraud. And there's been problems in some of the program design, which leaves it vulnerable to redefault. That's when someone who gets a mortgage modification, but is still unable or unwilling to continue to make the payments, either because the payments are still too unaffordable or because they're too hopelessly underwater. To Mr. Allison and to Treasury's credit, after receiving that audit report, they announced some significant revisions to the program that do address things like underwater mortgages, carving out $14 billion of the program just for one program alone with FHA. Those announcements also raise some significant concerns, which are addressed in our quarterly report. But we're hopeful and confident we'll continue to work with Treasury to assist them in making this a program that will be have the impact that the dollar amount that's committed to it should deserve.
And when you speak about your hope to continue to work, has the past, a recent past, been rocky in that relationship? Are things getting better if they have been rocky? How do you see it? Because we in this panel want you all to get along.
I think we do get along. I think the nature of...
Just in case, just for the record.
I think we get along. I think the nature of our oversight... We're very rigorous in our oversight.
Well, that's the key. We want you to work together. We don't want you to get along too much. You know?
No, and I think that while there has been certainly areas where we've had disagreement, sometimes very passionate disagreement, I credit Treasury. I credit Mr. Allison. We're all working towards the same goal, which is helping to make sure this program protects the American people. It maximizes its efficiency and is. Best protects against risk of loss from fraud. I think we have a great working relationship. Mr. Allison and I spend at least once a week we sit down and discuss the TARP issues. And as I said before, I think that sometimes we have to work a little bit longer and a little bit harder to get them to see our way. But overall, this program is in much, much better shape because of the willingness of Treasury to work with us and to try to meet us at least halfway, sometimes all the way on our side with some of our most important recommendations.
SIGTARP's budget request of $49.6 million is higher than the budget request of the Treasury's Office of Inspector General, which is $30.3 million. So why is your organization so much more costly to operate? How much do you pay for contracted services, and what types of services do you contract out?
Sure. The scope of our operations has changed dramatically since the ESA was first passed, and originally it was contemplated to be one program, basically to buy $700 billion of assets, direct purchases, a relatively straightforward program. It's changed a lot since then. As I said before, 13 sub-programs that put a lot of demands on our agency, which I think are a lot different, not just from the Treasury Inspector General, but from most non-special Inspector Generals. We don't just address what's going on within Treasury. And in other words, our oversight just isn't over Mr. Allison's office, the Office of Financial Stability. Because of the way that these programs have evolved, for example, in the Capital Purchase Program, we also are providing oversight to to not only the Treasury entities, but also the FDIC and the Federal Reserve. We also take a very aggressive role because we really are the sole law enforcement authority over all TARP-related programs, that really makes an expansive jurisdiction. A Treasury Inspector General doesn't necessarily get out to those who come into the government for programs. So let me give you just an example. AIG, Bank of America, and Citi have devoted a lot of our audit and investigative resources. More than 700 banks, probably closer to 800 banks, just through one program, the Capital Purchase Program, and we're responsible for safeguarding those investments. The HAMP program is 110 different servicers, a lot of the large banks, and potentially millions of applicants coming in through the door. The TALF program is a very complex program run by the Federal Reserve and Treasury that involves 15 or 16 primary dealers and their customers. The PPIP program is nine, now eight, sophisticated hedge fund asset management, which has tremendous amount of challenges. So I think one of the reasons why our scope, our budget is larger, is that our scope is very broad and our responsibility is very broad. And I would compare us to other Special Inspector General. For example, we based a lot of our growth on the Special Inspector General for Iraq Reconstruction, which oversees about $50 billion compared to our much larger scope of thing. And our budget, when they were reaching their peak, is right around the same area. Other inspectors general, just by way of example, when Arrow was passed, one inspector general commented to the press that it would only leave him with resources for one auditor per $1 billion, which that inspector general thought was an unmeetable goal. If we had a one auditor for every $1 billion, our audit division alone would be 700, not even counting our investigations. We've taken cost very, very seriously from day one, and we try to be frugal, we try to be prudent, and above all, we try to get the most bang for our buck to get as much coverage as possible for this breathtakingly complex and vast program.
Thank you. Ms. Emerson.
Thank you. Thanks so much for being here, and thanks for the great job that your office is doing under your leadership. It really makes those of us who have to live and breathe this every day feel a lot better, because you all are watching over our very precious tax dollars. Let me ask you mentioned some of the audits and that sort of thing that you had done, and I read it in the part of the quarterly report I got through last night. I must say I didn't finish the whole thing. But last year you stated in written testimony, and I'm going to quote, "We stand on the precipice of the largest infusion of government funds over the shortest period of time in our nation's history. History teaches us that an outlay of so much money in such a short period of time will inevitably attract those seeking to profit criminally. If by percentage terms some of the estimates of fraud in recent government programs apply to the TARP programs, we're looking at the potential exposure of hundreds of billions of dollars in taxpayer money lost to fraud," end quote. So, number one, have your fears materialized, and have you been able to find any large-scale fraud in the TARP programs? If so, what types of fraud have you uncovered? And then third, how closely are other agencies such as HUD, the FBI, SEC, FTC, and the U.S. attorneys working with y'all to investigate and prosecute cases of fraud?
I believe that ultimately the success of my organization, of SIGTARP, historically will be judged by how we do against those typical numbers of the 10% burn rate for the FBI. Sometimes it's 7%, sometimes it's 12%. I think we're really well on our way, because even more important from our investigative functions, I believe, in detecting and bringing people to justice, is how much we do as a job of deterrence through building and making our recommendations to make these programs as safe as possible, and then for getting the word out and making sure that those who are contemplating committing fraud know that we're out there. We certainly are seeing fraud. Fraud would be inevitable of a program of this size. We're not so far seeing anything close to what the typical government burn rate is for fraud. Now, we still have a ways to go, but to be sure. But I'm very, and we really try to get out in front. So I mentioned in my opening testimony the TALF-PPIP task force. That's not just a law enforcement group where we sit around and figure out ways to arrest people. A lot of our recommendations came from those discussions. We try to get experts from the SEC, from the FBI, together, so we can make these programs well-designed. I think the TALF program, when we originally started, when it was originally pitched to us by the Federal Reserve, it had virtually no fraud protection whatsoever. It was going to rely on rating agencies and investor due diligence, the two things that led to this financial crisis in many ways. I think now this program is remarkably well-designed. They took our recommendations to heart. I remember they came down the day after our first initial report, came down to Washington and sat with us and worked with us, and put in some really, really good protections. Sometimes they went beyond what we said, which we thought was terrific. They kept residential mortgage-backed securities out of that program, which was a pretty courageous move. I mean, this is something that was announced by the Secretary and the Chairman of the Board of the Federal Reserve, that they were going to put these securities through that program. We had real problems with it because we didn't think the program was well-designed, and they listened to it. So real quick, I hear the buzzing. We've had wonderful cooperation with the Department of Justice, the U.S. Attorney's offices, our law enforcement partners. We work with HUD OIG. We work with FDIC IG. Really every law enforcement agency that has a hand in white-collar law enforcement works with us on our cases, Postal, ICE, and we also work with state and local authorities as well, like the New York State Attorney General. The New York State Banking Superintendent is very supportive in our recent case in New York.
Appreciate that. Thanks. I think just to let the other colleagues get a question in, I'll
I thank you. Mr. Fattah.
Let me go back to the chairman's question about contracted services you contract out for. You didn't describe any or make any response to that question.
Oh, I'll be happy to. What we've basically for contracting, obviously ESA gives us the authority to do so. And when we do our contracting, we always try to do it when it's most cost effective. As a temporary agency, we have to be sort of selective in what we bring in-house and what we contract out, because we're not a permanent organization. You know, to build and hire up.
Tell us what you do. What kind of services have you contracted out for?
Perhaps our most significant contract is a program manager to help us with the production and design of our quarterly reports. The quarterly report has a tremendous amount of data that we collect in it, that we crunch and turn into charts and numbers. We do extensive vetting, and we have a contractor, Deloitte, actually, Financial Advisory Services, which assists us in that. We then have a bunch of smaller contracting services, everything from cars for our investigators, our special agents, to buy, you know, supplies for them, rent, obviously, as well as, you know, parking spots. We have other advisory services that help us with, you know, some of our human resource functions. We don't do all of our human resource functions in-house because, as I said, as a temporary agency, it would just be too expensive.
Now, your total personnel complement is?
Right now, we're at 116 FTE.
Okay. Now, can you guesstimate for the committee the percentage of women, African Americans, Hispanics? What level of diversity? You said, since you are the cop for TARP, and you know, we're always interested in the question of how diverse the picture might be. So, could you give us a general?
I don't want to hazard numbers because I don't have them, but I'm happy to get those numbers to you.
Okay.
If we have, assuming our HR department keeps track of them, I know that I've emphasized from day one to all of my senior managers who do the hiring on down, the importance of diversity, and we certainly strive for it.
And your senior managers, is it a diverse group of people?
I believe our senior staff is remarkably diverse.
And in your contracting out, have you utilized women and minority-owned, veteran-owned firms?
Yes, we actually required in our contract for our largest contract with Deloitte that they subcontract to minority small business women-owned small business. Also, with our other smaller contracts, advisory contracts, I know that's been an emphasis. As I said, I don't have the numbers and statistics at my fingertips, but I will get them for you.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, if we could have that request made for the record. Thank you very much.
And my deputy reminded me that when we went out and contracted to crunch for our use of funds survey, we did hire a minority woman-owned small business as well. So it's something that's always on the forefront of what we're thinking, but I just don't have the data.
Okay. Thank you
and
very
we
much.
We will make that request on the record.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be as brief as I can, but I wanted to ask, do you know how much money the Federal Reserve has loaned out and to who and under what terms and conditions? And can you provide that to the committee, please?
We did a comprehensive review last July of not just the Federal Reserve, but all the different federal government support of the financial industry during the crisis. So we'll get you a copy of our July 2009 report. I fully plan to update that on our next quarterly report this July. And obviously we'll provide that to you as well.
I'm sorry I didn't see it. Does it give detail as to who, what entities the Federal Reserve loaned the money to? Because that's always been a concern to members of Congress. Who are they loaning my daughter and our kids money to, and under what terms and conditions?
Ultimately, that decision may be made by the Supreme Court.
They're not releasing the information.
Federal Reserve doesn't disclose it. There was recently a decision in the Second Circuit Court of Appeals that's going to order them to make available that type of information.
Okay.
My understanding is they're appealing that decision.
I bet. Could you send that to me? I'd love to see the court case, too. We're running short of time. The Hope for Homeowners program that the chairman asked you about, that's in Section 110 of the TARP bill, I recall. It's now Title 12 of the United States Code, Section 5220. Was that the same program you were talking to the chairman about?
No, actually, Hope for Homeowners is something a little bit different. That's a HUD program.
It's a separate program, but I mean the statute TARP references that the purpose of this subsection of TARP is to implement the provisions of Hope for Homeowners. Is my point right?
In certain aspects.
Do I remember it correctly? That's the section we're talking about of TARP.
I don't remember the exact section.
But the language of that section says that the federal property managers, I recall, can encourage people to stay in their homes, to encourage homeownership consistent with Hope for Homeowners program. The federal property manager can, if to the extent that the federal property manager or the Treasury owns a mortgage-backed security or mortgages, reduce the amount of the principal, reduce the amount of the interest, or rank any other modification they wish. Is that accurate?
That's
what it is, isn't it?
I mean, essentially, I think that was sort of a carryover of what TARP was originally intended to be, which was the idea that the federal government was going to go out and buy toxic assets, including whole mortgage loans, mortgage-backed securities. Because that never really has come to pass, I don't think those provisions have really.
But they're there, and that's the section. Is that the section you're talking about? They said that you said to the chairman there's 230,000 permanent modifications been made to mortgages. I think that's the same program, isn't it, Mr. Chairman?
No, Congressman, that's actually.
Yeah, same program.
It's a separate program that's been initiated under TARP called the Home Affordable Mortgage Program.
Okay, completely separate.
Completely separate. There, the government doesn't own the mortgages. They're actually owned by private investors through private label mortgage-backed securities or Fannie and Freddie, which technically is not the government owning those mortgages.
Mm-hmm.
But that program addresses privately held mortgages. We don't really have, through TARP, an inventory of mortgages, although that was what perhaps was originally intended with the legislation. It's not what came to pass.
Well, I wish you'd run this down for me because it's in statute, and I spotted it when I voted against the TARP, but this was one of many reasons I voted against it, but it was a real source of concern to me. This other program you're mentioning to me, does the federal government then have the ability to insist that the bank modify the principal, reduce the interest, or make any other modifications they can to keep the person in the home or keep somebody in the home?
Once a mortgage servicer signs into the agreement, and so far more than 110 have, which covers about 90% of the market, they're required to run a net present value test, a computer model, that determines whether or not the mortgage modification, which would be certain incentives provided by the government, if that will make more money for the investor than rather than just doing nothing. And when that NBV test is positive under the program, the servicer is required to, it's mandatory, to do certain modifications to the mortgage. Under the current program, that starts with a reduction of the interest rate, and then it's followed by other factors like extending the term of the loan or forbearing.
Tell me again the name of the program.
That's the HAMP program, the Home Affordable Modification Program.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know we need to go vote, but it was a concern just because of obvious potential for fraud and abuse.
No, and we are literally all over this program. We have more than two dozen criminal investigations pending relating to the HAMP program.
Two other quick questions. What, if you could ballpark the total amount of the exposure of taxpayers, in your opinion, the potential liability of taxpayers, how much have taxpayers been exposed to, both through the Federal Reserve and through Treasury, through this TARP program and other guarantee programs like it?
In July of 2009, when we did this analysis, it was about $3 trillion. What we're going to see is, as I said, we're going to update it this July, and we'll give you an updated number at that point.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. There's no way that we can leave to vote and come back. That'll take quite a while, and we don't want to have you wait here. But you've answered most of the questions I was going to ask, so I'm going to ask one more, Ms. Emerson, and then we'll let you go. And this one is one of those great loaded questions. So if your staffing number is lower than expected in 2010, we assume that you'll have money left over to carry into 2011, which means you won't need all the 49.6 that you're asking for 2011. Is that a fair assumption, or are you going to tell me now how you need every bit of the 49.6?
I'm told by my budget folks that we do, and the reason is that we have a lot of expenses that I think we anticipated that were going to be incurred in this year, in 2010, that are not going to be. Specifically with respect to our information technology, we still, right now, we're sort of doing it with Band-Aids and duct tape. We have to build our own IT structure, not completely from scratch, but decide on what off-the-shelf products were going to be used. We've been relying on Treasury to sort of get us through. And what I've been told is that those funds are not going to be spent in 2010 and are not reflected in the 2011 budget. So the extent that there's carryover, that money is going to be still spent in 2011, and that carryover will apply to that. We do anticipate spending all of our annual money, the money that we're being provided for 2010, that will be spent. There will probably be something left over of our no-year money, which was part of the initial allocation, and I apologize if I'm getting the terminology wrong. But again, as my staff tells me, that because we haven't realized some of the expenses that we thought we would in 2010, that they're going to be realized in 2011.
Okay, we'd like you to keep us informed of that. In other words, staff and speak to staff as we go along to make sure that we feel comfortable that even if you don't meet the goals you expected, that we're still not giving you more money than you should be getting, only because across the board,
everybody needs it.
Everybody is very tight, and we don't want to run into any problems. Ms. Emerson.
Okay, 222 people haven't voted, and we have 0 minutes remaining, so very, very quickly. Because I'm still bothered by this, and I just am, with regard to the Treasury Department back in December approving a tax rule that allowed Citigroup to avoid paying billions of dollars in taxes. And I understand that this ruling will help make Citigroup shares more valuable, allowing the Treasury to make more money when you sell the Citigroup shares that the government owns, but I guess it's just difficult for me to understand why a company that received tens of billions of dollars in government bailouts should receive special treatment in the tax code. So I want to know if you've looked into this matter and whether or not you believe that the government will receive more revenue when Citigroup shares are auctioned than it would have if the tax rule hadn't been changed.
This has been an issue that we've spent a lot of time thinking about. And actually, Representative Kucinich has sent a letter to myself as well as to Senator Baucus, the chairman of the Tax Committee in the Senate, asking us to do two parts of a project that will review that. Our side to review the decision-making process that went in, that led up to that decision, and on the Senate side to do a review of what the actual costs were, what's the dollars and cents. It's a very complicated and complex formula. Originally, I was hopeful that we would be able to, you know, we were thinking about doing it ourselves. We can't. We don't have the expertise. We would have to contract it out. It would cost a fortune. So we're going to work with the Senate and work with the Tax Committee and get to the point where we can, you know, make sure that that part of the project is being addressed. And if so, we are certainly committed to addressing our part of getting and auditing what the decision-making process is.
Okay, I appreciate
we agree
it.
That it's a very significant concern. It's a concern where basically the stock price was of Citi is being potentially buoyed, which is benefits the government as a 28% shareholder of the common stock of Citi, but it also benefits those other 82%, so or 72%. So it is something that's on our radar screen.
I appreciate it. It's just there's something that just smells funny about it to me. So I appreciate the fact that y'all are going to look into it, and we'll appreciate hearing back from you about what you may have found.
Absolutely.
We'll all be interested in that. So, Barofsky, we thank you, first of all, for your service. We thank you for the work you do. We thank you for testifying before us. We're sorry that we're kind of rushing here, but we're at zero, and there are at least 4 votes, which means this will go on for a while down there. We don't want to keep you waiting here for us. So we thank you. We will continue to be in touch, and our staff will continue to be in touch. And what you do is very important to our mission here to keep us informed and to do the right thing. We thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.